Long-term goals, again, continue to focus on the dilapidated structures. There's a lot of them around town, secondary structures especially. And then community relationships. An example of that, we had our monthly code meeting a couple weeks ago, and I was given a packet of information from Habitat for Humanity for severely dilapidated structures to help out property owners. I've given out two or three of those packets to try to help people out, because ultimately, sometimes I have to give out bills, but in my eyes, I'm not in the business of handing out bills. I'm in the business of trying to fix an issue. So if we can do that and help out the community as much as possible to get these issues fixed without sending out a bill, I'm all for it.
Good for you.
Yep, that's the right way to look at
good
it.
Good approach.
Any questions from council?
Thank you for your efforts.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Job well done.
Thanks.
Thank you, Dust.
Next up is item B. This is to consider a resolution levying a special assessment against private property for snow removal. That's in accordance with Section 12.12 of the City Code. And so this is the time for the public hearing. Certified notices were sent to each property owner, and a notice was published in the Oskaloosa Herald. If approved, the property owner has 30 days from the time of filing with the Mahaska County Treasurer to pay for the snow removal in the city clerk's office, and then after 30 days, it's assessed to their property taxes with a payment schedule at 9% interest. There's six properties in the listing here to the council. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak to this? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution levying the special assessment?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roll call, please.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Dross?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item C is a resolution levying a special assessment against property owned by Wilda Collister at 610 D Avenue West in Oskaloosa, Iowa, to clean up and abate a nuisance. The explanation being given to the council is that the nuisance abatement was performed in accordance with Oskaloosa Municipal Code 8.08, and the timeline was on September 24th of 2018. Code enforcement staff noticed the junk and debris on the east side of 610 D Avenue West. On September 12th, code enforcement staff revisited the property, noted minimal change, and formal notice to abate was sent to the property owner, giving them 14 days to abate the nuisance. On September 23rd, staff revisited the property, noting no change. All documentation, including photographs, were forwarded to the city attorney for legal action. And on December 19th of 2018, judgment was entered on the property at 610 D Avenue West, giving the property owner 10 days to abate the nuisance. And then on January 3rd of 2019, code enforcement staff revisited the property at 610 D Avenue West, noted no change. In fact, more junk had been placed on the deck. And on January 4th, the nuisance was abated. And so do we have a motion, so it's a public hearing opportunity. Is there anyone who would like to speak tonight? Okay, seeing none, I'll close that. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roll call, please.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Dross?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item D is the imposition of, consider the imposition of levying a statutory civil penalty on the first offense sale of tobacco products to a minor. It's the time and place for a public hearing regarding charges for selling tobacco to a minor. A public hearing is required before the City Council can impose charges. The charges are regarded a first violation of selling tobacco to a minor for Jiffy at the address of 315 A Avenue East. So I'll open the public hearing at this time. Is there anyone who cares to speak to this? Okay. Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the imposition of a statutory civil penalty on Jiffy?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roll call, please.
Calgary?
Yes.
Dross?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item E is to consider a resolution approving and authorizing a form of loan and disbursement agreement by and between the City of Oskaloosa, Iowa and the Iowa Finance Authority, authorizing and providing for the issuance and securing the payment of $3,176,000 of sewer revenue capital loan notes, Series 2019, of the City of Oskaloosa, Iowa, under the provisions of the Code of Iowa and providing for a method of payment of said notes and approval of the tax exemption certificate. And so the funds from the bond issue will be funding Phase 3 of the inflow and infiltration improvements project and the 2019 sanitary sewer improvements project. The resolution approves the loan and disbursement agreement that also sets forth a number of covenants and agreements on the part of the city with respect to repayment of the loan. The agreement for the loan is between the city, Iowa Finance Authority, the Iowa Department of Natural Resources, and Wells Fargo Bank of Iowa. And a copy of the tax exemption certificate and loan disbursement agreement is available at the city clerk's office and will be available at the city council meeting if anyone should care to look at it. So, do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Wish you had more choice in spending $3 million bucks. Roll call, please.
Dross?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Bellinger?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item F is to consider a resolution reserving the right to authorize the use of right-of-way by wireless and wireline communications providers by establishing various policies and rates. So in the explanation, small cell communications infrastructure is currently being developed in larger cities, and it's the basis for the next generation 5G wireless networks. It typically involves installations of small antennas and equipment on structures in public places, often every few hundred feet, and by multiple service providers to provide enhanced service to concentrated areas that are much smaller than traditional cell towers. To accelerate the deployment of the small cell technology, Iowa and several other states have passed legislation mandating that the placement of the equipment in right-of-way is a permitted use. The Federal Commerce Commission, FCC, has adopted similar regulations which limit municipal authority and zoning control and place limits on fees and review time. Additional information is attached in our packet here, including benefits and risks of the technology. It was brought to our attention this week that cities have until April 15 to approve the policies regarding the facilities. The Iowa City Managers Group circulated our attached resolution for consideration, which is intended to retain our limited rights for oversight, and they also circulated a model policy document that will be considered separately from this one. Staff is recommending approval of the item. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution?
Moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Why did it come up so sudden? I mean, it looks like we're lucky, but I don't. Is this a legislative deal? And we weren't reading our newspaper?
Well, Mayor, Council, it's a great question. I think one of the things, this was passed a while ago, and then cities and communities in general had 180 days from the ruling to come up with these guidelines. And I think what was happening is you saw some cities trying to figure out what that looked like. The League of Cities is our lobbyist, so we don't necessarily have anybody else in tune with this. And so for us, it was a matter of waiting to see if there would be any model ordinances or policies put up in place. What we're trying to do is essentially, we're not trying to say don't do this for anybody who wants to invest in 5G in Oskaloosa, that'd be great. But what we want to do is at least have something in place that we can walk back from. So if we don't take action, then we won't be able to regulate them. We won't be able to charge a fee. But if we at least put this in place now, we can talk about that going forward. And if we want to repeal that in the future, great, we can. But you wouldn't be able to implement something after the fact. So we're just suggesting this, as are a number of other communities, just as essentially a defense mechanism, allowing us to walk through this and make sure that it meets the community's needs. If we were a community that had a lot of buried power lines and utilities, is probably a bigger issue than it is for us. In the information, you can see the size of the equipment. It's not enormous. Is it going to look any worse than a transformer? I don't know, but if it's every 500 feet, maybe that's not what we want. So at least by putting this in place, we believe that gives us the ability to at least say that we can do something.
And it goes in a row. Right?
In right, yeah. Correct.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Other comments? Roll call, please.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Alagieri?
Yes.
Dross?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. So getting to item G then is to consider a resolution adopting small wireless facility design guidelines. So it was brought to our attention this week that cities have until April 15 to approve policies regarding the deployment of small cell wireless facilities within the public right-of-way. The Iowa City Managers Group circulated the attached model policy document for consideration and adoption. Do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
Move.
Second.
Discussion on that?
I guess just a question as I read through the policy, and I'm a long ways from even knowing what I'm talking about when it comes to this, but what little we've talked about, or at least I understand it, it's when you're going to have a lot of people gathering in places that this would really be helpful, where more people could access the internet and have access to different things. And I noticed one of the places we don't want it is downtown, but yet we're going to be moving forward with so many things downtown, Art on the Square, where there'd be big gatherings, and then people, you know, that's when they're going to want access. And so that was my only question mark, is saying that that's a least preferable location. I know we're not saying not to put it there or you can't put it there. I'm not sure I felt comfortable with that being in there. I would think we want lots of people coming downtown. We certainly wouldn't want them not to be able to access the internet once they're down there, or to access the Wi-Fi. Just a concern I had with the policy as written.
Yeah, I don't know, Sean, you have any?
Yeah, I think that's a fantastic point. And this is something that was pushed in the model ordinance. Historic districts were in there as well. I think the way it's written, it would not prohibit placement of these downtown, but it's stating it would be one of our least preferable locations. And it states the preferences, industrial districts being one. And I think first we would look beyond the downtown area. If we can go the next block to the west or to the east of it and provide the same coverage, then I think that would meet our needs and then the providers as well. If that's not a possibility, then I think you're right. Then we would need to look at existing facilities in the proper downtown area.
Thank you.
If I could clarify a little bit. So this isn't Wi-Fi. This is just like you would have to subscribe to this service. So it would be like you have a cellular carrier, because they'll be the ones that have the 5G service. So you'd have a Verizon account or an AT&T account or Sprint account. And so it's not public Wi-Fi. It's a service that you would subscribe to. So wherever it's located at, if you don't subscribe to their service, you won't utilize this service.
It's absolutely correct.
Yeah.
And you could have multiple providers, just like you do
correct.
Now with Verizon and AT&T. But the technology operates similarly to Wi-Fi, where it just covers a very small area, just a few hundred feet.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was at Sprint for 10 years, and they were working on it then. So this is, you're a couple hundred feet apart, mm-hmm. and you could have these. So, for instance, you mentioned no above-ground facilities, take Fox Run, for instance, where there are the only poles out there are light poles. So they'd have to use those light poles because there are no utility poles out there, so to speak, to hang these off of. And quite frankly, coming late to the game like this, the FCC's pretty much mandated that you're going to do it one way or the other in the community. You're just trying to minimize the amount of damage you're going to do by they've said they've got to be the same color, the wires have got to be the same color as the poles they go on. We've got Wi-Fi on the square right now, and it's painted the same color. It's mounted on the bandstand on three sides, and it's painted the same color as the bandstand, so you don't even see them hardly. So, but yeah, for this service, it'll be just like you subscribe to MCG or MediaCom or CenturyLink, or quite frankly, it'd be Verizon or Sprint. That's who the folks are bringing it, so, or T-Mobile, I guess. So, yeah.
Well, did I understand it right? If there are no poles to use and they put their poles in, if there's several people doing it, we're going to have multiple poles.
Well, they talk about the fact that you could have multiple radios. I mean, every pole could have a different company's radio on it, quite frankly. I don't know what to think. I mean, you know, these folks aren't going to, they got to do it every couple hundred feet to make this service work. They call it micro towers. So I don't know how soon we're going to see it in rural America. As soon as I say we won't see it, it'll be here next week. But, I mean, it's probably going to be in the major metropolitan areas where they can get a return on their investment pretty quickly. And so I don't know how soon we'll see it in Oskaloosa. And certainly, I don't know when you're going to see it every 200 feet out in the rural countryside. So.
All right. Other comments? Okay. Roll call, please.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Bellinger?
Yes.
Johnson?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Gets us to item H. Let's consider a resolution for preliminary approval of plans, specifications, form of contract, estimated cost, ordering publication of notice of hearing, notice to bidders, setting the date for a public hearing, and authorizing to receive and open bids, all for the facade improvement project phase two. Curtis Architecture and Design has prepared the plans and specs for the Oskaloosa Facade Improvement Project Phase 2. This allows the staff to proceed with scheduling the public hearing on plans and specs and also set a bid letting date for the project. All the documents referenced in the resolution are available for viewing at City Clerk's office. Project includes facade improvements at the properties at 109 South Market Street, 115 South Market Street, 117 South Market Street, 119 South Market Street, 121 South Market Street, and 119 First Avenue West. The preliminary architectural opinion of probable cost is $674,406. The project has received a certificate of appropriateness from the Oskaloosa Historic Preservation Commission and approval from the Iowa Economic Development Authority for compliance with state historic preservation standards. So if the project's awarded, construction would be expected to begin in early June with completion by the end of calendar year 2019. Bids will be received and opened on Wednesday, May 8th at 2 o'clock p.m. and presented to the City Council for public hearing on Monday, May 20th. Staff is recommending approval of the item as presented and approval of the resolution scheduling the public hearing for Monday, May 20th of 2019. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on it?
You want me to say it? It's Davis Bacon.
Here it comes.
All you guys know where I'm at.
Yep. Let the minutes reflect.
Cost a third more than it should.
Storefront sure looked nice, though.
Oh, yeah. It looked just as nice for a third less, wouldn't it?
Other comments? Roll call, please.
Wally?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Strauss?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item I, consider a resolution accepting the Oskaloosa Creative Placemaking Action Plan. McClure, the city's placemaking consultant, presented the results and final recommendations of the Placemaking Action Plan to the Steering Committee on February 22nd and to the City Council at a study session on March 4th. The action plan is available for viewing online at www.oskaloosaplacemaking.com and is divided into six categories. There's dining and socializing, improved connectivity, arts and entertainment, the William Penn connection, housing, and finally beautification and wayfinding. The steering committee met on April 4th to review the work and begin prioritizing actions and identify leaders and subcommittees that will work to implement the plan. The committee reiterated their support of the action plan concepts and recommendations presented and requests the general acceptance by the City Council. Emphasis here. The committee also reiterated that the Council's acceptance would not make all the action items mandatory. Rather, it would enable the committee to reach out to the community to further consider the recommendations and seek additional assistance where necessary and proper in pursuit of the action plan items. Staff concurs with the steering committee and is recommending council accept the Oskaloosa Placemaking Action Plan. Do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Discussion.
Well, I'm for it. And I was glad to see that sentence you read would not make all action items mandatory, rather would enable the committee to reach out to the community to further consider the recommendation and seek additional assistance where necessary and proper. That kind of bothers me. Who's going to decide what's necessary and proper? And my point only being, and it won't do any good to vote no, because it's a good thing, but we don't want to go through it again that, you know, any surprises, and I hate to bring it up, but I'm going to, you know, we're going to tear down the bandstand. Okay, we don't need that. So move forward with it, and I think the group's very good. They've worked hard on it, and they will assure that. Mm-hmm. But That's my speech.
Yep. And we want to be clear here that there is not a recommendation in there to tear down the bandstand, just in case somebody wants to quote you.
I didn't say that, but...
Other comments? Roll call, please.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Ross?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Okay, gets us to item J, I believe. Consider a resolution approving an agreement with SVPA Architects for the Early Childhood Education and Recreation Center project. In the description, on April 1, 2019, the City Council authorized the City Manager to negotiate a contract with SVPA Architects for the Early Childhood Education and Recreation Center project. Since that time, SVPA and the City's Legal Counsel have exchanged comments on a draft American Institute of Architects agreement, and that's attached here. As of Thursday, April 11, portions of the draft AIA contract language still needed modified to better protect the City's interests. The City's Legal Counsel and SVPA are working towards ironing out those details, but the information contained in Attachment A of the agreement that includes a fee proposal information will remain unchanged. And based on the information, staff is recommending that the City Council approve the item, giving the Mayor, City Clerk, and City Manager the authority to execute the contract documents pending the Legal Counsel's concurrence. Providing approval to this item allows the project to continue uninterrupted as the contract changes get made. In the event the City and SVPA are unable to resolve contract changes, or if substantive changes are proposed to the document from what's attached, then the Mayor and staff will delay executing the contract and revisit the item with the City Council. And so do I have a motion supporting the resolution approving the agreement with SVPA, subject to attorney recommendations and changes as necessary?
So moved. Second.
Okay. Discussion.
What items are holding us up, I guess? I'm just curious as to what type of things those could be.
As you might appreciate, the AIA document is drafted in a way that helps protect the architect's side of things. And so our legal counsel has a number of changes that would essentially give us a little more protection. The legal team is from Allers and Cooney. They're who we use on all of our bigger contracts. They've worked with SVPA on other projects, and so they were surprised to see that they hadn't incorporated their preferred language into this draft. And so that's what's taken a little longer, is that they expect that to occur.
Did we have that same issue like when we hired the architect for the fire station? Because I didn't remember that, and that was a standard AIA.
There was some back and forth. They've handled that particular AIA review, and there were changes that you had requested.
Yeah, there were some. It's always interesting with language, as Mike says. It's certainly drafted with a particular viewpoint, and the one that I'm always... Thank you, once again, looking out for me. The one that always amazes me that they always put in there, of course they want it, they say, in the event we do anything wrong, the extent of our liability is limited to the fee you're paying us, which is absurd if you think it through. But it's fairly typical. Obviously, they try to put in a lot of boilerplate language for them. You kind of have to, that's favorable to them, of course, you have to kind of try to ferret that out.
So some of the changes were they can't proceed with different phases of the work without concurrence from us, written concurrence. So they want that, our attorneys want that in writing. That's an example. So that wasn't in there. A lot of it is not proceeding with work without our approval. Or if there are design changes that would be sought, again, that we would make sure that was boiled down into writing before they actually started working on. So it's to help avoid additional fees. Those are some of the items that I noticed in the review.
So, I mean, do we feel we have an issue, or
no.
Is it just a matter of time?
I think it's just an issue of timing. Between the award or the notice, basically, from the last meeting, the architects took a little bit longer than I expected to get the draft AIA to us. And so our attorneys started their review Friday, late Friday afternoon, really actually Monday. And so by the time I got this together, we were scrambling, and they asked me, what do you want to do? Are you hard and fast on this date, or are you okay with us working this out and getting counsel to ask counsel for approval to approve pending these changes. And I said I wasn't really interested, given what I saw in the changes. There are a lot of them, but they're not deal breakers. The funding isn't changing. The amount of what we negotiated isn't changing. So it's just getting some of the finer points ironed out. I think we're okay with that. Our attorneys seem to be good with that, too.
And as I understood talking to Michael earlier today, if these changes don't get accepted, we will hear about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there's more changes now than what's in this draft?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I'd still like to say what Doug said last meeting. The group that worked on this between the three entities has worked very hard and looked at it awful hard. I mean, I think we're on the right track, and I'm pleased with the architect we're dealing with. So,
and I think the architectural team is anticipating that there won't be any issues because they've already set a schedule for having our kickoff meeting on April 24th with our committee team. So, again, I think they anticipate that this all get resolved without any problems or having to revisit this at our next meeting in May.
I just hope them taking longer on the contract isn't a sign of things to come on the project.
No, more of it's an issue of having our attorney make sure that the attorney took a few days okay. to review it.
All right. Thank you.
Other comments? Roll call, please.
Burnett?
Yes.
Caligari?
Yes.
Drost?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Gets us to the end of the agenda. Opportunity for reports from city staff, city manager.
Mayor and Council, included in your packet is a memo from Public Works Director, actually City Engineer Keelish, to me, and it gives you a little bit of perspective, additional context to the conversation that we had at our last meeting when it came to easement acquisition and how we've been handling some of our contacts with the public. I think what I readily admitted to you in my update last week was that we weren't necessarily really prepared for having a drawn-out conversation during last council meeting, and I don't think that's appropriate for those. It's not the right setting for the conversation that would be necessary. But wanted to give you the understanding of the amount of time and effort that our staff and our legal team spends on acquiring easements for projects. And so with the wastewater projects that we've been working on, 127 construction easements needed to be acquired. That's a lot. I mean, that's a heavy workload that if we had to contract that out, we would be spending a lot more money. And the fact that our staff is doing that and Dave is doing that on retainer without additional fees is a good thing for the taxpayers and ratepayers. Most of those easements, like I mentioned during our meeting, do not require compensation. And so Mr. Heaton had some concerns that we weren't offering anything or that maybe we had changed it where we were in our position. Well, our position is always to start at zero. We hope that the community will understand that if we need a construction easement for the utility, that they're part of that system and that they'll provide that with no compensation required. So that happened on 109 of the easements that we've worked on. 17 of them did require compensation, and some of the compensation was cash, but others could have been trees or bushes or shrubs or sod. So we try to figure that out. If we're going to disrupt someone's yard, we try to figure out a way to replace it in a like manner. I also put in here where we were with the negotiations and how far apart we were. And so, again, while we should have and could have done additional follow-ups with the people involved in this, if we're that far off, I do support our staff moving on. I mean, we were light years away in price. And so if we need to move that particular conversation down to the bottom of the pile and move on, I support our staff in doing that. Because there are other things that have to get done. So anyways, this is what's provided to you. We give you an outline of how we would like to do things going forward. And then in my email, I also provided you a little more detailed memo as well. So just wanted to make sure we had follow-up on that conversation or that item from the last council meeting. The other item, Mayor, I would note for you is that I attended a study session, albeit I had to leave early, with the county supervisors to talk about 220th Street and trying to find some type of resolution with that issue. The county at their last meeting prior to this one today had voted no on accepting or wanting to financially participate in any alternative plans for the relocation of 220th Street. So we will have to have a conversation about what that means in an upcoming meeting and talk about what our response to that would be, along with our partner, City of Pella. So we're going to come back together in the near future to discuss that, but I would say that wasn't necessarily good news, but it's something that we will need to talk about more. That's all I have, Mayor.
Okay, very good. City Clerk, anything?
No, sir, thank you.
Okay, City Attorney, anything?
Nothing, thank you, sir.
So we'll open up to the council members. If you got anything to bring to us, also any reports from boards and commissions that you might sit on? Bob?
No, sir.
Joe?
Not at this time.
Okay.
No, thank you.
Okay.
Nothing tonight, sir.
Mm-hmm. Tom?
EMA and 911 meets Thursday. I haven't had a meeting for a while. Radios are moving forward in their own application, but it's working, I think, so that's good.
Okay, good to have that. Okay, Steve, anything?
The only thing I've got is I wanted to thank someone. I didn't know her very well, but every time I ran into her, she was perfectly pleasant and always, quite frankly, a pleasure to talk to. Marilyn Johannes retired from the city clerk's position last Thursday. Was her last day?
In the city manager's office.
City manager's office. Okay, not city clerk. I'm sorry. City manager's office after 34 years?
More than 34 years.
And that's a pretty amazing thing to serve a community for that long, and I just thought that she ought to get a shout-out for that. So I just want to thank her for that service.
Good job, Steve.
Yeah. And I would ditto
that. Thank you, Marilyn.
Yep. Anything else?
Nope, I'm good. Thank you.
Okay, and I would ditto that as well, that on a lot of the proclamations that come out of the mayor's office, Marilyn Johannes is the person who works between me and whoever the entity is that's getting the proclamation done. And so a lot of times things will not be particularly well organized. She did a nice job of especially getting people to understand what it is that we were doing, making the draft document look like it was something that could be framed for a long time to come. And then finally getting everyone there that needed to be there. And so she operated as not only to support the city manager's office, but also to support me, and certainly made the job of being mayor much easier. I also wanted to bring attention to a letter that we received from the Arbor Day Foundation that City of Oskaloosa has earned recognition as a 2018 City Tree City USA city. And so this is something that happens from year to year, but not without a tremendous amount of work from volunteers in the community. So we are thankful to be able to have that designation as well. With that, do we have a motion for adjournment?
Moved.
Second.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Aye.
I can count that down for you.
Yeah, you get the